This Woodwork is sponsored by Microjig.
Ever since I built my lathe duplicator all that time ago, I've really wanted to make an upgrade to it to cut wooden spirals on the lathe, and so with a little bit of time off now over Easter, I finally managed to do it. Because I didn't have an exact idea of what I was building and I was just doing this on the fly, I didn't take the time to film me building this. But now with everything kind of working how I want it to, I thought I would take the opportunity to show you each of the individual components and give you a really good idea of how everything works together to produce the wooden spirals. And then I think we can have a bit of fun and do a few test runs. So I think we'll start over this end of the setup where we've got the handle.
Everything up this end is attached to this little makeshift plywood box which I put together, and that screws directly onto my original lathe duplicator. The little handle here provides movement to the entire rig. It's a little bit further away from the bearing it's mounted on than I would like, but I needed it to protrude far enough past this point here for me to crank it. The shaft which the handle attaches to is just a simple threaded rod, and that is mounted to two little rollerblade bearings which I've attached in the plywood. There's one bearing on each side of the plywood, and I just drilled a little recess to house each of those bearings. And so the shaft attaches to this little 16 tooth timing pulley, which of course runs the timing belt which I've got running along here. If I move quickly down to the far end, I've got this second little idler pulley which again is running on two little rollerblade bearings, and that's attached to this little piece of plywood which has a threaded rod running through it, which if I rotate with just my thumbs I can tension the timing belt. It's not too important what sort of timing belt you use. This was just a 2.5mm timing belt which I was able to get really cheap on eBay. And the timing belt is just fastened to the underside of the carriage of my duplicator, and it just performs a big loop from one end of the rails to the other. And so when I rotate the handle, the timing belt is just moved by the pulley, which causes the carriage to move along. With the lateral movement sorted, now I can come back to this end, and you can see that the timing pulley is also attached to this drill attachment. I bought this 90 degree drill attachment for not very much money, and that translates the rotational motion here through 90 degrees because I need to send it that way in order to rotate the lathe. The output from the drill attachment is sandwiched in these two little pieces of plywood, and that's just a really crude method for me to attach the rotation from here to a set of sprockets on the output. On the other side here, I've got a set of sprockets which I've mounted on a little block of wood which I turned on the lathe, and that's attached to a bolt which again is mounted onto several bearings on this piece of plywood. I've just put some gloves on because these are still quite greasy. I of course managed to salvage these from an old bike. And so if I move on, you can see that this sprocket here is attached to a second sprocket up here which I've attached to the headstock of my lathe. Again, I turned another piece of wood on the lathe which I could then pass a bolt through to attach this second sprocket. The easiest way I found to attach the sprocket onto the tailstock was to remove the existing handle, and that left me with a sort of standard size shaft which I could then screw onto. And then here I've rigged together just a sort of basic tensioning mechanism out of the gear changer on the old bike, and I've just got this long spring here which I can hook onto a little screw, and that provides enough tension to keep the chain onto the sprockets. Unfortunately, as you can see, there's quite a bit of wobble in both of the sprockets. And that's probably due to the way that I've mounted them on these wooden blocks, but there doesn't seem to be a whole lot I can do about that, which is why having this sort of long spring here sort of enables me to provide enough sort of movement to vary the tension. and it seems to be doing just about okay, so I'm having to leave it at that. You may also have noticed this other little idler sprocket which I've left here, and that's purely to take up some of the chain slack if I move on to one of these smaller gears. The nice thing about having a set of sprockets is I can achieve different ratios depending on which of these sprockets I select, and that means so if I moved on to this smaller one I could get more lateral motion for each rotation on the lathe.
And so of course the end result of all of these gears and pulleys and chain is a certain amount of lateral movement of the router for a given number of rotations of the lathe spindle. Now you don't actually need to use a lathe for this to work, you just need something that's going to hold your two centers, and that could be something as simple as a couple of pieces of plywood and a few bolts that are free to rotate.
I felt that this video was already getting a little long, so I decided to split it into two parts. So please join me in the next video where we'll be experimenting and performing a few test runs with the new spiral jig. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.